And I'm obviously delighted to be here because we're going to be unveiling the 2022 Golf GTI and Golf R. And I think you'll really enjoy driving these vehicles when we get to driving them later in the year. I'm also delighted to be in Chicago when it's actually above freezing. I mean, normally I come here, I've been here 20 years, and it's usually been about 50 degrees below, so this is a welcome change. So anyway, without further ado, I'd like to introduce Ryan Schaefer, who's our Senior Vice President of Product Marketing and Strategy, to talk about the car. So take it away, Ryan.
All right, good afternoon, everyone. I think just to echo Mark's sentiments, of course, very good to be around people and cars again. I think it's been over a year since we've seen many of you. So very excited to be with you. I'm going to save you a lot of the details around the craziness that's gone on in the past year, from tons of computer meetings to lack of computer shortage chips. I'm not going to go through all that details, but what I do want to do is briefly take you through a quick update from our brand, and then we're going to get into the stars of the show, which you see here behind me. Now, I think probably arguably the biggest headline for us this year has been the launch of our first long-range electric SUV, the all-new ID4. The vehicle's been very well received. It was sold out before reaching our shores, and also sold out before it was actually announced as World Car of the Year. So extremely exciting, the ID4. It was also not the only SUV we added to our lineup. We also added the all-new Volkswagen Taos. That's now the fifth SUV in our lineup. A really well-packaged little car, and really aimed at that kind of entry-level compact SUV segment, and we've seen great success with the Taos as well. Now, if we take a step back a little bit, and I don't think this is a surprising figure, if we go back to 2020 and we talk about the US car market, well, 54% of the sales in the US car market was comprised of SUVs. So it's no secret that Americans really enjoy their SUVs. And with this new lineup of five SUVs, our first 6 months, year to date, has seen SUVs make up almost 70% of our total sales. And obviously with the market coming strong, coming back post-COVID, and us having, I think, a five-car SUV lineup, we've seen good growth from our brand. And how have we achieved that? Well, first and foremost, Tiguan remains our best-selling SUV. It also remains a best-selling global SUV. And then I think on top of that, on top of the Taos and the ID4, we've also been very fortunate with the story on Atlas and CrossFord. And if you look at the Atlas and CrossFord, we added the CrossFord last year. We've seen great incremental volume by adding the CrossFord to the Atlas lineup. So Atlas and CrossFord now comprise 33% of our sales, and those two combined have really seen us grow our market share and our segment share in that mid-sized SUV market. So it's safe to say if the SUVs are performing well, I guess the brand is also performing well. And we've been very fortunate that if we look at the year-to-date sales of our brand, need some help with the clicker, it seems to be jammed a little bit. Year-to-date sales, 46% up on year-to-date last year. So for the first 6 months of the year, we're up 46% on last year. We've had a 3 month running spell of sales north of 40,000 units. And I think you really got to go back to the early 1970s to try and find a period where Volkswagen sold north of 40,000 cars a month. So obviously extremely exciting for us. Now, I've spoken a lot about SUVs, but obviously we are still also a car brand. And if we look at those cars, you can maybe help me out, advance these slides, the clicker is not functioning. If we look at those cars, obviously we still have the Jetta, the Passat and the Artion. The Jetta will receive a facelift a little bit later this year. We have the Passat, the Artion recently facelifted, and the Artion also due for a couple more upgrades next year. So we've spoken about SUVs, we've spoken about sedans, but obviously the star of the show here today is obviously our small hatch, the Golf R and the Golf GTI. And since this car obviously has launched in Europe last year, I think we've all been eagerly awaiting the arrival of the MK8, GTI and R here. But in February we managed to get our hands on a couple of the EU spec cars. We managed to collect a couple of old generation Golfs, and we managed to collect a couple of friends. We all headed out to Summer Point in Virginia to have a little bit of fun, and I'm going to give you a quick overview of how that went down. So I think today, talking a little bit about our heritage, I think it makes sense to go right back to the beginning.
That's right. This is where it all began, Haim. This is the Mark 1 Rabbit GTI, as we called it in the U.S., and this is definitely what started it all for Volkswagen with the GTI. This car was definitely unique for the time, and Americans were looking for something that was smaller, more practical, yet still very fun to drive. Enter the Mark 1 Rabbit GTI.
Okay, so fast track to today. And let's talk about the Mach 7. And this really was quite a significant change relative to the Mach 6, right?
Absolutely. So from a platform standpoint, the Mach 7 was completely new from the ground up. We had the first version of Volkswagen's MQB modular transverse platform, one of the longest standing GTI generations in the US, but also our most successful in terms of sales.
Okay, so that's the GTI today. I think let's take a walk down memory lane and let's go back in time a little bit again. The Mark 4 R32.
This was the very first Golf that featured a combination of the 3.2-liter V6 engine, 6-speed manual only, and the 4-motion all-wheel drive. First time to have all three of those together in a Golf in the U.S. And this, the Mark 7 Golf R, third generation of the E888, still paired with 4-motion all-wheel drive, but bumping it all the way up to 288 horsepower just really made this car an absolute blast to drive.
Okay, so the Mach 7 arguably was the most popular generation of the R, right?
Absolutely, Hein. Over several model years, the 7th generation Golf R really...
Hein!
Oh, my word.
Hey, Hein, no worries. We made it.
Guys, we're trying to shoot a video here.
When exactly did you put that on?
In the tent last night.
That is scary.
Okay, can you two kids just grab a car and get out of here so we can turn it on?
I'll take the green one.
Rabbit edition for me.
Of course.
Knock yourself out.
Is your license even legal here? I'll just leave.
Hein, we gotta get back to the clubhouse.
We could take the Mach 7, but I think I've got a better idea.
Okay, so we had a little bit of fun on Sonic Point, and of course I think you probably want to see what's under the wraps. So I could carry on talking about Golf R and GTI all day long, but I'm actually going to invite some friends on stage who've got to experience the car with me on Sonic Point. They know how these two vehicles perform. So ladies and gents, join me please and welcome on stage our Head of Product Marketing for the Golf lineup, Megan Closse, and our Brand Ambassador, Jamie Orr. So first and foremost, did you really drive the country all the way to Summit Point? Did you really sleep in it?
That was not really magic. I did go cross country in the Marcy Bell, and it was fantastic.
And mildly disgusting.
I did literally sleep in the tent on top of it.
And Megan, I mean, we know that you're an R32 enthusiast. We can see your car parked out there. You and I both had our R32s on the track. How fun was that?
There was something phenomenal about having multiple generations of GTI, Golf R, R32, and being out at Summit Point and driving these cars and getting to experience them for the first time. That's just something that will go down in the history books for me personally.
Cool. But we're not just to talk about all R32s or countries, so I think let's get the sizzle reel going and let's get the covers off. Ladies and gents, I'll ask you to stay back there. We're going to tell you a little bit about these cars straight after we reveal them. And then, of course, later on we'll have a light lunch, but we ask you that once we reveal the cars, you will get an opportunity to come up on stage. Let us reveal them, and we'll talk you through the details, and then we will open up. All right, let's do it. All right, so there you have it. Although we did have some EU spec cars for Summit Point to mess around with, as you saw from that video, these are the first of the American spec, both GTI and R. And I think all the plan right now, Megan, is for you to talk us, maybe let's start on the GTI, talk us a little bit through the new Golf market at GTI.
Thanks for the introduction, Hein. Good afternoon, everybody. It's my distinct pleasure to be here and finally reveal these cars in person to you all. Of course, this is the Mark 8 GTI. It's the 8th generation of a model that began its life in the late 70s in Germany, came to the States in 1983, and just to go back down what we call memory lane a little bit, the original GTI was kind of an in-house planning and project of these engineers who had the sport-minded idea of, let's take a base Golf, sport up the suspension, the engine, the interior, the exterior, put on nicer wheels, and essentially you have the Silver Mark 1 Rabbit GTI behind most of you, which we proudly call the original hot hatch. Now, most of you might remember fondly the original car, right? It had the dimpled golf ball shift knob, it has the sport plaid seats, it has the red accents on the interior and the exterior, items that have carried throughout almost every single generation of GTI. Sporting a 5-speed manual, a whopping 90 horsepower, naturally aspirated, of course, from a 1.8-liter engine, nice little 14-inch alloy wheels. The car was really an all-around fun car to drive that didn't force compromise in any of the areas of practicality, fuel economy, efficiency. But that formula is something that has worked very well for us through the years, of course. The hardware has changed quite a bit, again, even if the formula has not. So at its heart, the Mark 8 GTI is still very much a classic GTI. We've got honeycomb trim, interior and exterior, red accents throughout the vehicle on inside and out, golf ball manual shift knob, of course, and then sport plaid seats, which as well, 13-inch. As far as this GTI, it's really unlike any other that we've seen before. It's a whole new world of driving, technology, and conveniences. It's starting at an MSRP of $29,545 for the S-trim with the manual transmission, which we feel is a very reasonable price uptick from its predecessor, considering the fact that you get a great deal of new standard equipment on every single trim level of GTI, power upgrades, and big chassis and handling improvements. Sporting the fourth generation of the EA888 2-liter turbo direct injected motor, 241 horsepower, 273 pound-feet of torque, mated to a 7-speed DSG, or, of course, a 6-speed manual transmission. Also featuring an all-new vehicle dynamic setting system, which will oversee all electromechanic system of the chassis to deliver the most engaged, the most linear, the most fun GTI ever, even at the limit of its handling. It's also the first GTI in North America to feature optional 19-inch alloy wheels from the factory, which, I don't know about you guys, but the 19-inch wheel is quite a far cry from the 14-inch alloys of the Mark 1. So speaking of driving dynamics, putting Jamie on the spot here, since he has had a good amount of track time in the Mark 8, Jamie, tell us about your experience in the Mark 8 GTI.
Genuinely, it is a big step forward, and I don't say that lightly. The Mark 7 was sensational. I was so fortunate to drive it from 5 different continents, from Pan South America, including crossing the Andes, the Bolivian salt flats in the Mark 7. So I love that car. If we were magically able to drive blindfolded, I know you'd be able to tell the difference between the Mark 7 and the Mark 8. It is that much of a jump, but absolutely do not try that at home.
Thanks, Jacob. So while the chassis, the driving dynamics, handling, and power output have all increased, the interior is also more technologically advanced than ever as well. So starting at the heart of the vehicle for the driver, you've got the new standard Volkswagen Digital Cockpit Pro, which features multiple different modes of display, an available heads-up display, 30-color ambient lighting on the interior. Also available are 8 to 10-inch MID3 infotainment displays, a whole new frontier of haptic and touch feedback controls on the interior as well. And then, of course, bringing back that GTI heritage on the interior, you have the racier touches, right? Like the perforated leather steering wheel that is heatable, leather trimmed, of course, and front seats with integrated head restraints, which we feel is a pretty cool sporty touch as well. Other standard features include LED headlights and taillights, LED fog lights in an X-shaped pattern, and the IQ Drive suite of driver assistance features. Now available, we have an all-new Harman Kardon premium audio system, a sunroof, our DCC adaptive damping system, ventilated front seats, and even heated rear seats. We feel that this is the best GTI ever. We do have our own biases, but we feel that you will find that as well when you have a chance to experience the car, drive the car. More standard equipment than ever on a GTI, our most powerful GTI ever, with a small uptick in pricing. So we think you'll love it, but we also think that you'll love the all-new Golf R, so I'm gonna flip it back over to Hein. On that note, thank you all.
Awesome. All right, so I think before we go to the new Golf R, let's maybe take it back in time a little bit again and go back to, I think it was in 2003, when Volkswagen R really had this bright idea of making a very unique hot hatch. And what they ended up doing was cramming a 3.2-liter VR6 engine, listed to a closely ratioed 6-speed manual transmission. They added a full-motion all-wheel drive system, bolstered sport seats, 18-inch multi-spoke wheels, and a really cool signature exhaust note. And I'm talking, of course, of no other than the R32. Now, we were very fortunate in the US to get roughly 5,000 of those. They arrived here in 2004, and they almost became instant classics, and I think if you scrounge the used market, their values continue to rise. 240 horsepower, full motion, absolutely a groundbreaking Golf. And after the R32, there were two more generations, I believe in the Mark 5 and the Mark 6, mated to later on even a four-cylinder engine, but still continuing with a very secret source of all-wheel drive traction, more grip, more horsepower, and more performance. And I'm very proud to present, I think, the Golf 8, Mark 8 R, and we really honestly truly feel that this is really the generation where the Mark 8 R separates itself even more from a GTR in terms of performance and in terms of drivability. So the Mark 8 R is powered also by that four-cylinder engine, producing now 315 horsepower and 290 pound-feet of torque for the DSG transmission model, which as you can see is quite a significant difference over the GTI. We started the MSRP for the manual transmission version at $43,645, and the buyers who buy this car will ultimately have access to significant improvements in performance and the chassis. This is the most powerful Golf ever produced, and this car versus the outgoing Mark 7 is completely loaded with standard features. Now, many enthusiasts will look at a car and really judge it on how fast it is around the track, because that gives you a good idea of how good the car really is. We're very proud to report that the Golf R was taken around the Nürburgring Nordschleife and beat the Generation 7 car by a whopping 19 seconds. Now, if you've been around there and you look at those lap times, 19 seconds is not something to smirk at. So how was it able to do this? Well, it still has that very successful all-wheel drive system, but the new four-motion system also incorporates a torque vectoring mode and also a drift mode for track use. And in addition to that, you will notice larger brakes that are cross-drilled in the front. We have a radically revised DCC adaptive damping system, and really this Golf R is one of the best all-rounded machines out there. I know you got to drive it. I know we went around the track a couple times with Mr. Faust. Talk to us a little bit about this torque vectoring mode and how it works and how you felt the difference.
So the standard features are a few step forward, but that torque vectoring for me is the biggest game changer. It has a live display on the dashboard that you can physically feel it happening. There is 50% of power available to the rear, 50 to the front, but the game changer is 100% of rear power can go through one individual rear wheel. So what does that mean in the real world on an open road? The analogy that I use best comes from Mr. Faust. You imagine a canoe paddling you. That's what that back wheel is doing. It's pushing you out of the corner into where you're going, and you can feel that happening. So it is phenomenal. Normally at that pace, you're not able to see or look at your dashboard. You're looking at where you're going, but if you are, you can see just how much the handling is stepped forward with that. The additional driving modes do include the off-road use only drift mode as well, which we won't go into too much, but I hope you get to experience it and have a blast doing it. The photos of that on the track are not photoshopped in the slightest. This car will. You have a look.
You can see Jamie's bound by lawyers, so I do apologize for that. That's awesome. And then I think the other exciting news, Megan announced it on the GTI, which we retained the stick shift, and we are very proud that the Golf R will come in manual transmission as well. So that's very cool. You can just move us on, right? Thank you. So I think on the interior, the Golf R pretty much is very similar to the GTI. You'll find the same very digitally focused and highly technological upgrades on the interior. Of course, we go with blue accents on the R versus the GTI, which of course is littered with red. And I think in terms of the overall package of the car, there's definitely no shortcuts when it comes to features, convenience, performance, and of course, most importantly, that whole fun-to-drive factor. Now, unlike the GTI, we have a very simple offer structure for the R. We have one trim available in either DSG or manual. It is roughly $3,200 more expensive than the outgoing model, but it is loaded with a lot more standard content, and I'll just briefly touch on those. So, upgraded leather seating surfaces, a sunroof, now standard in the car, heated and ventilated front seats, a Harman Kardon premium audio system, 3-zone climatronic, a heads-up display, a very nice 10-inch infotainment display, and last but not least, as you can see on the side over here, beautiful 19-inch wheels with summer tires, which are also standard on the car. So ladies and gentlemen, there you have it, the new Mark 8 GTI, the new Mark 8 R. Megan, Jamie, I'd like to thank you for joining me on stage. And at this stage, I'd like to welcome you guys up. Feel free to ask